Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of The Confession by Beverly Lewis, narrated by Barbara Caruso. This book is copyrighted 1997 by Beverly Lewis. This recording is copyrighted 1999 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. Katie Lapp's identity had been shattered the moment she found the satin baby dress in the attic of her parents' Amish home. Painfully torn from her close-knit community in the frightening ordeal called the Shunning, Katie, now Katherine Mayfield, sets out to find the mother she has never known. And now, The Confession.
Part 1. One can never consent to creep when one feels an impulse to soar. Helen Keller. Prologue. Katherine. I remember everything about my first glimpse of Cousin Lydia's kitchen. It was modern as the day is long and all aglow with electricity. Being a curious 3-year-old, I'd set out to reach the light switch, making determined grunts as I stood on tiptoe, stretching myself up, up, while peeking around the wide door jamb to see if the grown-ups were watching. At last my little fingers touched the magic. Off! And on, and off, and on again, I made the long white ceiling lights buzz and flicker, splashing fluorescent gleams onto the floor and the wallpaper. I must have played that way for a good 5 minutes or more. It was Dot who told me to stop. "You mustn't be playing with the lights, Katie. You might burn 'em out," he said softly but sternly. Then he scooped me up in his long arms and carried me to the front room with the rest of my plain relatives. Nearly 20 years later, I had to smile at my renewed interest in the light switches found in every room of Peter and Lydia Miller's Mennonite farmhouse, especially the shiny gold one in the boarding room I now called home. Being raised Old Order Amish meant I'd never lived around such fancy things, and for all good reason. The Ordnung, an unspoken list of church rules and regulations that had put a damper on my every word, deed, and oft-times my thoughts, too. I, sadly enough, had gone and broken those laws, several of them. Hadn't kept my confession promise to Bishop John, refusing to destroy a forbidden guitar. In return for my wickedness, I was to be shunned all the days of my life. All my life. If, and only if, I was willing to go to the bishop and repent, bend my knees in earnest contrition, pleading with God and the church membership for mercy, only then could a sinner such as I ever be brought back into the fold of the people. So Katie Lapp, the secretly adopted daughter of Amish parents, was as good as dead. Shunning practices were carried out that way in Hickory Hollow, the way they'd been seen to for 300 years. But what of Katherine Mayfield, my real name and the real me? Well, I couldn't imagine Katherine thinking twice about a kneeling confession for what I'd done. Not for love nor money. There was too much at stake. Still, the steady ache in my heart persisted, and sometimes on the clearest of days, from high atop the second-floor landing window, I managed to make out the snowy outline of a distant roof and double chimneys, the old farmhouse where I was raised. True, Samuel and Rebecca Lapp's sandstone house was just 1 buggy mile away, up Hickory Lane a bit, though it might have been a good 100 miles on dark December days like today. 'Cause standing here, staring my past in the face, it seemed my whole world might fade to a deep, dark purple if I let it. Stubborn as I was, though, I refused to give in to the searing pain of rejection and betrayal. Wouldn't let the memories of the shunning drape a dark cloud over my future. In a peculiar sort of way, that was my salvation. That and my Mennonite relatives. If it hadn't been for Peter and Lydia, I might have succumbed to despair. but they had a way of treating me like I was really and truly one of the family. Clear from my first day here. My eyes had begun to open up in more ways than one. The way they talked to God, for instance, why, it was downright astonishing at times. Oh, I'd heard them say blessings over the meals off and on through the years, but family devotions and the prayers that followed were brand new to me, ever so joyful. And what singing! 3- and 4-part harmonies filled the house every evening after supper. My guitar had found a temporary home, and so had my broken heart. Answering to Katherine instead of Katie took some getting used to, for sure and for certain. There was no easy way to change something as comfortable as your own first name, just because one day you up and decided you were someone new. Still, I was determined to try. Sometimes Lydia had to call me 2 and 3 times to catch my attention. I suppose it wasn't so much the sound of Katherine that threw me off. It was latching on to what the name stood for that was the biggest struggle. For truth, I belonged to someone who'd never known the Ordnung and its confining practices, someone who understood all about the busy modern world I'd missed out on. My birth mother, Laura Mayfield Bennett, she was my true kin. And if I could trust what I'd been told, the woman was dying of some greislich, dreadful disease. I needed to act quickly, but the fear in my heart was powerful strong. At first it held me fast, even kept me from learning to drive a car or from trying out the telephone hanging high on the wall in Lydia's kitchen. But there was something I didn't hesitate on, something no amount of fear could keep me from doing. Cousin Lydia drove me to town and dropped me off at the prettiest beauty shop I'd ever seen. Of course, I'd never darkened the door of one before, just looked from a distance and wished. Didn't have an appointment, but they took me right in and cut and styled my hair just the same. Glory be! What freedom I felt when the scissors started snipping away at my long, uneven locks that'd never been cut my whole life long. Well, the weight of the world fell right off me, in a heap of auburn hair all over the floor. I shook my head and the air swooshed through it, clear to my scalp, and I asked myself why on earth I'd waited so long for something so awful nice. The answer was bound up in rules and expectations, same as my waist-length locks, tied up in a knot under a veiled covering all these years. But there was no need for me to be carrying around a head full of long, too thick hair anymore. I was free to do whatever I pleased with it, and my face. Clothes, too. A wonderful good feeling. Staring in the mirror, I saw Katherine Mayfield's painted lips smiling back at me. When she whispered, "How do you do?" I heard the refined sound of her English voice in my ears. Still, it would take some practice to get it right every time. I reached up and ran my fingers through my shoulder-length hair. Honestly, feeling it so bouncy and free gave me the shivers. The new cut gave me something else, too. A curtain of soft curls. "You have beautiful natural waves, Katherine," the beautician said with a big smile. What a day! The curls, so long hidden, had finally made their appearance. I was more than grateful and told her so. As for Lydia's telephone, I realized I couldn't be waiting to use it any more. Couldn't let the fear hold me down. So I got real brave. 5 days after coming to live in this fancy house, filled with electricity, microwave ovens, forced air heat, and the tallest, prettiest Christmas tree I'd ever seen, I picked up the Lancaster phone directory and made myself read all about how to dial up a long-distance operator. Then, closing the pages, I thought about the sin I was about to commit. Would I never stop straying from the path of righteousness? Seemed to me I'd sinned so awful much, though. What would one more transgression hurt? A sense of urgency swept over me. My natural mother was dying. She wanted to see me. I wanted to see her, to know the woman named Laura, wherever she was. Enough of this pondering over my faults and misdeeds. It was high time to take the first step toward finding my roots, a giant step, to be sure. I reached for the telephone. Chapter 1. It was dark and bitter cold when Laura returned from the attorney's office. She was weary and sighed audibly, bearing the weight of this most recent appointment. Theodore Williams, her longtime chauffeur, peered at her over the leathered front seat of the limousine. "Mrs. Bennett, are you all right?" "A bit tired," she replied. "Please don't be concerned." "Very well," came the deep yet gentle voice. She allowed herself to lean hard against the back seat, waiting for Theodore as he made his way around to the trunk. Oh, how she longed for the days of mobility, freedom to come and go as she pleased. Could it have been only 1 month ago she'd braved the cold and the distance, hiring her driver to take her to a remote Amish community in Pennsylvania? She hadn't felt up to such a trip even then, but at least she had been able to get around while there without much help. Regrettably, the mid-November jaunt had turned up not a single lead. Her daughter, her only child, had not materialized, even though Theodore had so willingly backtracked to various spots in and around Hickory Hollow before driving home the next day, back to the place of her childhood in the Finger Lakes region of New York. Yet in spite of the futile search, she had held stubbornly to one small hope, that an Amish woman sitting in a carriage in front of a general store might have followed through with Laura's request. She had entreated the elderly woman to deliver her personal letter to one of the many Rebeccas living in the community, specifically to the only Rebecca who would understand the desperate, handwritten plea. The woman whose adopted daughter was to celebrate her 23rd birthday next summer, June 5th. The familiar sounds of Laura's empty wheelchair, its thin tires making contact with the cold pavement, brought her from her reverie. She began to straighten herself a bit, sliding forward in the seat as best she could, despite her frail and weakened condition. In an instant, her chauffeur, dressed in a tailored black suit and overcoat, opened the car door. She lingered a moment, struggling to button the top of her coat against the frigid air, as Theodore stood in readiness behind the wheelchair.
"Rosie? Miss Judah?" he called toward the house. "Mrs. Bennett has returned."
In the space of a few seconds, the housemaid arrived, followed by Laura's live-in nurse. The two women gently assisted the mistress of the house, easing her out of the black car and settling her into the wheelchair. Theodore paused judiciously. Then, "Shall we go?" Laura gave a slight nod and was cautiously wheeled over the wide circular drive, freshly plowed from a recent snowstorm, and into the Tudor-style mansion. A magnificent Christmas tree stood sentinel in the corner of the expansive entryway, adorned with white doves and lambs to represent divine peace and the Lamb of God, respectively. There were lovely cream-colored roses, ivory stars, clumps of dried baby's breath and hydrangeas, and hundreds of twinkling white lights. Laura breathed in the pine scent, relishing the rich holiday fragrance. "Will I live to see another Christmas day?" she wondered, glancing away from the enormous tree. She fought back tears. "Will I live to see my Catherine face to face?" Faithful Theodore guided her chair down shimmering marble halls to the wide French doors in the south wing of the Bennett estate, at which point the venerable gentleman stepped aside, relinquishing the job to Natalie Judah, the nurse. "Do have a good evening, Mrs. Bennett," he said in a near whisper.
"Oh, I will. And you really mustn't worry."
Then, motioning for him to lean closer, she said,
"Remember, not a word to anyone. Are we agreed?"
"As you wish." Before straightening to his full height, Theodore pulled a long envelope from his vest pocket. "Shall I tend to this matter on your behalf?" Laura had only to nod. "Consider it done, Mrs. Bennet. Good evening." And he was gone. Once settled in the commodious suite of rooms, Laura allowed Nurse Judah to assist in removing the wrap she'd donned for her errand. That done, she extended her arm as Natalie checked her pulse with a gentle touch. Frowning, the young RN, dressed all in white, including hose and shoes, then smiled the faintest of smiles and patted Laura's arm. "You've had a strenuous afternoon," she remarked, turning to speak to Rosie. "I think it would be best to serve supper here, in Mrs. Bennet's private quarters." Rosie bit her lip momentarily, then made an obvious attempt to conceal her concern, and came near the wheelchair, resting her hand lightly on Laura's shoulder. "I'll see to it." Laura watched as her nurse set about preparing to administer the regular evening injection of morphine. Reticent and edgy, she stared at the needle.
"If you don't mind, couldn't it wait? Perhaps for just a while," she asked, not certain why she'd made such a request. "Oh, are you experiencing some kind of discomfort? Nausea? Pain?"
The truth was there had been no ill effects of her afternoon outing.
"I'd just like to rest a bit. It's been a tiring day," she replied. "We must be more careful from now on," Natalie reprimanded softly. "You mustn't overdo, Mrs. Bennet."
Laura understood perfectly, for her most recent attacks had come on with excessive fatigue and emotional stress, so much so she had made the decision to move her rooms to the main floor, primarily out of concern for her husband. A man of disciplined work hours, many of which were spent in his upstairs office suite, Dylan Bennet was easily distracted. And what with her needing constant medical attention, and with Nurse Judah and Rosie coming and going at all hours, she had relocated. More convenient for all concerned. Indeed, essential for other reasons unknown to her husband of 9 years. As a relatively new believer, Laura had become a Christian 3 years prior, she maintained her Heavenly Father was in control of her very life, and that of her long-lost child's. More recently, she had begun to pray in earnest for God's will as to hers and Catherine's reunion, a reunion her husband might not welcome. A solitary afternoon would suffice for such a visit, but she knew in the depths of her being it must be soon, very soon, before the crippling disease advanced to claim her life. The prayers and devotional time she enjoyed with other Christian women, Rosie Taylor, her personal housemaid in particular, had become a thorny problem, presenting something of a nuisance for Dylan. Her husband, who did not share her newfound faith, had discouraged her from having Bible studies and prayer groups on the premises. Had he put his foot down and absolutely denied her this social and spiritual outlet, she would have obeyed out of respect. She could only pray that Dylan would never resort to such a harsh measure. During one such discourse, Laura had to gently remind him that the estate, in fact, was legally hers, her childhood home, having been left to her upon the death of her widowed mother, Charlotte Mayfield, 12 years earlier. The comment was not well received by Dylan, causing more of a rift between them. Even so, Laura would occasionally invite a church friend or two for an intimate gathering, trusting that someday, in God's perfect time, Dylan might join her in the study of the scriptures. More important, that he would come to find peace with the Savior for himself. It had not occurred to her, however, that by making arrangements to alter her will, she might be adding fuel to the already stormy debate. In fact, not until Mr. Cranston, her attorney and private counsel, had mentioned it today had she even considered the matter to be an issue. Her ultimate decision was not born of a vindictive agenda. She was merely following the footsteps of her sensible and loving mother. That was the extent of it. But she must be discreet. And for now, Dylan was not to be the wiser. Natalie Judah went in search of her patient's warmest slippers, moving quickly past the lovely dressing room area, complete with jacuzzi bath and vanity, toward the large walk-in closet. on the way she grappled with her growing emotional attachment to the kind yet determined woman she had been assigned to nurse through a prolonged and difficult illness. Laura Bennett, a woman with so little life left in her. Nothing in Natalie's medical training had prepared her for the intense empathy she had come to experience with her first in-home patient, a woman much too young to be dying. In fact, Natalie had found it practically impossible to maintain, as she'd been taught, a semblance of professional detachment in the face of Laura Bennett's single-minded goal, obsession, even. So with all the nursing skills at her command, Natalie had determined to do her best to keep Mrs. Bennett alive to realize her fondest dream, to meet the daughter she'd given away at birth, the infant who would by now be a young woman. Sadly, all this presented a real dilemma. The very objective that drove the poor woman had the capacity to further weaken her, both physically and mentally. At times, her patient's diagnosis tore at Natalie's heart, for malignant multiple sclerosis was an explosively progressive disease. She did not have to be forewarned as to how the final stages would play out. Laura gazed with interest at the live, miniature twin Christmas trees perched on the cherry sofa table across the room on the very edge of her favorite Tibetan damask rug. Red velvet bows and long strands of wooden beads garnished the matching trees, resplendent even without tinsel or lights. She thought of all the Christmases she had missed with her daughter. The never-ending preparations, the gala events surrounding the season. Hers, completely devoid of the laughter of children. Had Catherine as a youngster fallen in love with the splendor, the music of Christ's birthday? Laura sighed as her thoughts flew backward in time. What sorts of things did Amish folk do to celebrate, she wondered. Had Catherine come to know the truest significance of the blessed season? Laura could only assume so, for surely the Amish knew and loved the Bible as she did. Letting her mind wander, she considered the plain community she'd secretly visited last month while searching for signs of Catherine. What was the chance of an Amish family giving up one of their own kin, by blood or otherwise, to spend time with a stranger, and all in response to a desperate plea? She thought back to the crucial letter. And if she had been able to stand and walk to her writing desk, she would have done so, for in the narrowest drawer lay a copy of her message to Rebecca, the adoptive mother of her child. Still, she knew it by heart, every word of it. The baby girl I gave to you has been living in my heart all these years. I must speak the truth and say I am sorry I ever gave her away. Now, more than ever, because you see, I am dying. Once again, her eyes drifted to the identical Christmas trees. Their bows and beads dazzled her. And she knew why, as a girl, her favorite colors had been red and green. She stared deep into the dense branches, daydreaming of other holidays. The breezy, casual days of girlhood, years before her precious baby daughter was ever conceived. Tears sprang to her eyes. Then, without warning, the colors began to blur. Laura felt the hideous muscular jerking, starting on her left side. Frightened and experiencing intense pain, she placed both hands on her thigh, praying silently for the tremors to cease. When they did not, she removed her hands slowly from her upper leg, hoping to conceal her true condition from the brunette nurse, who had just come into the room, carrying fluffy blue slippers. Laura squeezed her fingers together, locking them into a folded position, and pressed them hard against her lap. Natalie was not to be fooled, however. Mrs. Bennett, I really must give you a shot now, before your supper comes. The soft-spoken woman stooped to remove Laura's shoes, replacing them with her favorite house slippers. Nurse Judah rose and offered a reassuring smile, giving Laura the courage to accept the intimidating injection. Then, before the drug was ever administered, while the nurse prepared the syringe, the dreadful dizziness began. During the past several days, lightheadedness had frequently accompanied the frenzied trembling. It was at such moments she would lose control and cry out, fighting off her pain with the best antidote she knew.
"Oh, Lord Jesus, please, please help me," she would pray, whimpering.
Nurse Judah swabbed the vein gently. The moist cotton ball made a chilling, unwelcome path along the crease of Laura's arm.
"Can you make a fist, Mrs. Bennett?"
It was all she could do to cooperate at first, but slowly Laura willed her body to relax. And as the medication entered her bloodstream, the morphine began to work its miracle. After the uncontrollable quaking had ceased, a cloud of exhaustion gathered over her. In the midst of this heaviness, Laura thought of her long-lost girl and feared her own time was short. Theodore Williams made his way out of the house to the limousine, still parked in front of the grand entrance. Getting into the car, he thought of Mrs. Bennett's insistence on being driven downtown today. She'd certainly not looked well. Anyone could see that. But she seemed determined, at all costs, to discuss her last will and testament with Mr. Cranston. Theodore's suspicions could not be quelled. The ailing woman must have it in her mind that she wasn't long for this earth, for it was the urgency in Rosie Taylor's voice when she'd phoned at noon on behalf of the mistress that had alerted him. "Mrs. Bennett will not be satisfied till you agree to take her," the maid had said, stating quite clearly that no one else would do. "She insists on having you, and keep quiet about it, too." It was the latter remark that worried him greatly. A more kind-hearted lady Theodore had never met, and because Mrs. Bennett was not one to engage in manipulation or deceit, he was moved to help her as he had on at least one previous occasion. The memory served him still. That dreadful day when it was discovered her husband, shrewd man that he was, had been careless with the dear lady's accounts. It was then that the mistress had taken Theodore into her confidence, a rather rare and ponderous position for an old Britisher, solely in her employ. But he'd pulled it off, and quite successfully, too, arranging to drive her to an independent law firm, one completely divorced from Dylan Bennett's own accounts and financial dealings. To this day, and as far as Theodore knew, the man had not the faintest knowledge of any of it. None whatever. Prudence dictated that Theodore would continue to keep this tidbit as quiet as the present afternoon's journey, when, he had a most ominous feeling, Mrs. Bennett had gone and altered her will. He parked the black limo beside the white one, then opened his overcoat, reaching into his suit coat pocket, where he pulled out the long linen envelope, unsealed. He would not investigate its contents, to be sure, and since it was too late to secure it in Mrs. Bennett's safe deposit box tonight, he locked up the envelope in the glove compartment of the car and headed for the gatehouse. "I'll take care of it tomorrow," he told himself. "Yes, indeed. First thing tomorrow." Chapter 2. Lydia Miller turned off Hickory Lane and onto the dirt driveway adjacent to the farmhouse. She parked her car in the detached garage bordering the converted barn, where her husband and two of their oldest sons had years ago set up a woodworking shop on the main level. She saw that the lights were still on in the office area. Noticing, too, the abundance of light streaming from nearly all the windows on this side of the house, upstairs included, she chuckled, making her way across the snowy barnyard, arms heavy with two sacks of groceries. "Katie Lapp's certainly having herself a heyday," she thought. The electric bill was sure to reflect it. Approaching the house, Lydia wondered what it might have been like to grow up Amish, with few, if any, comforts of a modern home. The mere thought of gas lamps, battery-operated water pumps and horses and buggies made her grateful for the decision her elderly parents had made long ago, choosing a conservative Mennonite fellowship over the Amish church. When Katie opened the back door, Lydia almost forgot to address her by the new name, but caught herself in time. "How was your afternoon, Catherine?" A smile as bright as a rainbow crossed the young woman's face.
I used the telephone today for the first time. Ah, it ain't so awful hard, I guess.
Lydia shrugged her shoulders. It'll be old hat soon enough.
Yeah, I hope so.
Setting her groceries on the table, Lydia turned to the sink and began washing her hands. Then, with Katie's help, she put away 3 discounted boxes of dishwashing detergent and an array of other house cleaning supplies.
So, who'd you call, if it's any of my business? I talked to a lady operator in Rochester, New York.
Glancing over at Katie, Lydia hurried to set her at ease. No need for the dear backward girl to divulge the entire phone conversation. That's all right, really, tis. You don't have to tell me more.
Oh, but I want to.
Katie closed the refrigerator door and rushed to Lydia's side.
I can't believe what I did today. Honest, I can't.
Studying the young woman next to her, Lydia sensed the yearning.
So tell me, what did you do?
She asked softly, wondering if her cousin's daughter had already attempted to locate the ailing birth mother. Katie pulled out a kitchen chair and sat down, touching her long auburn locks, flowing free in wavy curls. Her brown eyes sparkled, and Lydia noticed a trace of eye makeup.
There are 48 people with the last name of Bennett.
48? Ay, 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 such a lot of long-distance calls.
From what Mama remembered, Laura lives somewhere near Rochester, I think. A city that sounds something like Canada.
Well, have you looked on the map yet?
Just the one in the phone book, you know, to get the right area code.
Katie beamed, looking right proud of herself. Proud in a good way, no doubt, being able to spout off modern things like area codes and such.
How on earth will you know if you've located the right person?
Katie nodded.
Could be awful tricky, I expect. But I have some good ideas.
Lydia sighed, feeling somewhat relieved.
Then you haven't made any personal calls there yet? Not just yet.
The hesitancy in the girl's voice was evident.
I wanted to ask your permission first. Let you know I'm willing to pay for all the long-distance calls I might have to make.
Then we should get busy. Lydia located a book of maps from the shelf under her corner cupboard.
Here, let's have a look-see. Maybe we can find a city in New York that sounds like Canada.
They put their heads together, leaning over the map on the kitchen table. Lydia's primly supporting her Mennonite cap, Katie's uncovered hair shining, tousled curls springing free, at odds with her upbringing. After searching and not finding anything, Lydia checked the index for cities in New York. Her pointer finger slid down the page as she calculated each entry. Here's one, she said. I wonder, could this be it? She pointed to Canandaigua. Sounds a bit like Canada to me. And the population is rather small, so there shouldn't be as many Bennetts to call. Katie laughed.
Ah, you rhymed just then. I did at that.
The two women chuckled merrily and set about preparing supper. Katie peeled potatoes while Lydia warmed up leftover ham and buttered green beans in the microwave oven.
Have you thought of praying about your search?
Ventured Lydia.
It would be a wise thing to ask our Heavenly Father for his guidance, don't you think so?
Katie kept peeling potato skins without looking up.
I don't know how to pray that way. Didn't learn, really. Never thought it was the right sort of thing to be doing, neither.
Well, I believe I know just the person to teach you, Lydia replied, an excited feeling welling up in her.
Just the one.
Looking up, Katie broke into a shy smile.
Ah, really?
I wouldn't fool you about something like that. Lydia turned and went to gaze out the large bay window, framed in hanging ferns.
My husband has taught many a soul to pray, Katie.
Catherine, Katie reminded her. Lydia was silent. For a moment she came close to apologizing, but let it go this time. She had considered the arrival of Rebecca Lapp's only daughter as somewhat of a mixed blessing.
The poor thing was really groping her way these days, insisting on a fancy name like Katherine Mayfield. Peculiar, it was. This and the fact that hers and Peter's home, dedicated to the Lord's work years ago, and their close proximity to the Amish community, made it rather convenient for the young woman to run from her past and rent a room outside her church district. Lydia wondered if she was doing the right thing by the shunned girl. And what of Samuel and Rebecca Lapp and their sons? What must they be feeling? The situation perplexed her, and she had the oddest sensation overall. While pondering earlier, she'd wondered why Katie had reacted so harshly to her parents keeping her adoption a secret. Was this what had caused the young woman to deny her own identity, or was it the shunning, the heart-rending way she'd been treated by the people that had changed everything so? Lydia shook her head, bewildered. She couldn't get over the young woman's worldly clothing. She'd lost no time in buying a fancy red wool skirt and that shiny satin blouse with swirls of red, blue, and gold flowers, of all things. She figured Katie must have surely shaved her legs, too, because she was wearing the sheerest of hosiery lately. And such a hairdo, all wavy and, oh, so much shorter than any plain woman, Amish or Mennonite, would ever dare to think of wearing. Katie's shoulder-length hair bothered Lydia to no end. The girl was constantly fingering it and tossing it about. The usual head covering was missing. Of course, now, what with all of Katie's bright-colored clothes, the veiled cap would look completely out of place. She sighed and turned from the window, touching the back of her own cap, Mennonite in styling. Surely there was a devout, plain woman, called Katie, hidden away somewhere inside the newly modern girl. Surely there was. Catherine's room was high in the house, situated under the eaves and neat as a pin. The smell of lilac had already begun to permeate the room because of the many handmade sachets she'd brought with her from home. There was a down-filled comforter all decked out with sunny yellow tulips, and a white and yellow striped bed skirt that fancied up the four-poster bed. The place was mighty large, yet different from anything she'd ever seen in an Amish household. And the maple furniture, every piece, thanks to Cousin Peter's woodworking skill, matched the other. A triple dresser with wide, movable mirrors, a tall chest of drawers with bright, colorful doilies, and two square lamp tables. No dark green window blinds, cold hardwood floors, or mountains of Amish quilts. Also, noticeably absent was any sign of a cedar chest, where a single woman could store hand-stitched items awaiting her wedding day. Catherine brushed aside the annoying thought. She'd gone and run out on her own wedding, leaving a disgusted widower groom behind, a man who'd turned out to be the sternest bishop Hickory Hollow had ever known, Bishop John Byler, the imposer of demeinting, the shunning. Ah, the very thought of it stung her to the core. But she was Catherine now, body, soul, and spirit. She stared at the foot of the bed where a hope chest might have been. 'Twasn't so important to have such a thing in a room for rent. Still, she couldn't help recalling the many lovely items she'd made during the years in preparation for her wedded future. All of it, every last hand-sewn piece she'd packed away in the Lapp's attic. Just thinking of it, she had to laugh. A choked sound, for it was the dusty attic of her childhood home where everything had begun to crumble and change. Crossing the room, she went to sit in the upholstered chair near a beautifully draped window. She lifted her tired feet to the hassock and let out a weary sigh. Above her, the ceiling light shone brightly, and she decided as she relaxed that this room was her haven against the world, the world of her people who had pierced her very soul. Shunned for all time. Once again, she was stricken with the paralyzing thought. Purposely,
She stared at the gold light switch across the room, and Cousin Lydia's words flickered through her mind. Ask our Heavenly Father for guidance, the Mennonite woman had said. But Katherine, had no idea how to do such a thing. Her strict Amish roots went too deep in her, maybe. Still, she mustn't accept that as a reason not to pray Cousin Lydia's way. Besides, she wanted to break all ties with her past. So praying as if you were talking to God, now that would be one way to go about it. She got up and knelt beside the chair. Dear Father in heaven, there's a Mennonite downstairs who says I should talk to thee, you, about finding my real mother. I do hope thou, you, won't be minding too much. She stopped. Such a strange way to speak to the Almighty. She resorted to beseeching him in German, as she was accustomed. O Herr Gott, himmlischer Vater, she began. It was difficult. No, downright bossy, to ask anything personal of the Lord God, Heavenly Father, especially since she was in bold-faced disobedience to his commandments. So she didn't make a request at all, but recited a prayer from Christenpflicht, the standard Amish prayer book, instead of a spontaneous one. After the prayer was done, she felt as though she'd broken faith with the new person she was attempting to become, Katherine Mayfield. Before getting off her knees, she spied the beloved guitar lying under the double bed. Retrieving it, she sat on the hassock, exhilaration replacing her sadness as she strummed the once forbidden strings. The lively songs she sang were old ones, some she'd made up as a little child. Another was a slower tune, one she and her first love, Daniel Fisher, who drowned in a sailing accident 5 years before, had written together during the last week of his life. Dan, she truly hoped, would be pleased up there in glory if he knew what her plans were for tomorrow. He was a spirited fella, Daniel Fisher. Never gave up trying till he got what he wanted, especially when it came to religion and the Bible. She remembered him being mighty stubborn for a young Amish man. Liked to ramrod his ideas through to those who didn't see eye to eye with him. Katherine sang on. Don't prejudge the dead, she could hear the conscientious voice of Rebecca Lapp, her Amish mama. Herr Gott was the final judge when all was said and all was done. The Almighty One was sovereign. Come judgment day, he would decide what would become of her dear Bose, eternal soul. Louder she sang, defying the thought of Daniel ever being anywhere but in blessed paradise. Never before and never again had someone understood or loved her more. And tomorrow, if Dan was looking down on her, she'd make him grin. Chuckle, maybe. She planned on using Cousin Lydia's telephone to dial up that long-distance operator in Canandaigua. She would not give up till she got hold of a woman named Laura Mayfield Bennett. Laura, who would understand perfectly. Laura, who would recite the day of her daughter's birth and say at last, Welcome home, Katherine. What a fine, wonderful, good day that would be. Chapter 3. Katherine waited for the house to clear out a bit before heading to the hall phone the next morning. She'd written and rewritten the directory assistance number for long distance on a scratch pad from the kitchen, anticipating the moment. But when she walked up the stairs and approached the telephone, she could only stare at it. There were so many things to be thinking about. If she picked up that phone... It just might be best not to know anything about her natural mother, really. Might be best to leave well enough alone. Her dear friend Mary Stoltzfus would say, Stick to doing the right thing, Katie. Well, if she was to do the right thing, would she be standing here in this Mennonite house this very minute? She shrugged off the crippling thought. Her heart, fractured and feeble, insisted on knowing the truth. But when she got up the courage to dial the number, the electronic answering service came on the line. Katherine waited, insisting on speaking with a real live operator.
"What city?"
the woman asked.
"Canandaigua."
"One moment, please." Katherine waited, her breath coming in shallow spurts.
"What listing?"
was the reply.
"I need a number for someone with the last name of Bennett."
"Spell it, please."
"Bennett."
"Thank you, one moment." The operator's voice sounded stiff, and Katherine wondered if that was how all of them talked. But she wasn't about to give up. She wouldn't let one uppity operator discourage her.
"There are 15 Bennetts listed. Is there a first name?" the operator asked.
"Please try Laura Mayfield Bennett. It might be under that name."
Almost instantly, the woman said, "I'm sorry, there's no such listing."
"Oh,
would you like to try another?" came the wooden voice.
"No, thank you. But could you give me the phone number for those 15 Bennetts?"
"I am authorized to give only one listing per call."
"Only one?" Katherine's heart sank. "But it's an emergency. Someone's dying. Someone... it's my real mother. She's dying, and I have to find her."
"I'm very sorry, miss. You may continue to call back, however, if you wish to try all the numbers for that listing."
Katherine resigned herself to the way things must be done. After all, hadn't she always followed the most rigid rules in dress, in word, and in deed since toddlerhood? Why not go along with one more?
The operator gave her the first name,
Arthur O. Bennett, and the number.
"Thank you," Katherine said, and hung up.
Then, fingers trembling, she began to dial, remembering to include the area code. Such a life these moderns have, she thought. On the other hand, she was still getting used to the simplest of conveniences. Last evening, before retiring, she discussed her plans with Lydia and Peter, asking permission to use their telephone again. They had agreed to let her reimburse them for the long-distance calls when the monthly bill arrived. It would take quite a bit of her money, but Katherine thought it cheaper than hiring a private detective. Letting her call long distance like this was one of the nicest things anyone had done for her lately. She heard the phone on the other end ringing in her ear. Once, twice, a third ring. Then,
"Hello,"
a strange voice said.
Could I speak to Laura Mayfield Bennett, please?"
Her knees were shaking along with her voice.
"Well, I think you may have the wrong number," the voice replied.
"Oh, sorry."
Quickly, she hung up. Not to be discouraged, Katherine picked up a pencil and drew a single neat line through the name.
"I'll just try the next one," she said,
as though saying the words out loud might give her a bit more confidence. But she hesitated, staring at the telephone. She thought of Cousin Lydia's kind suggestion of asking the Lord for guidance. Maybe she ought to get up the nerve to do it, or ask Cousin Peter before she tried. When she finally redialed the Canandaigua operator, someone new was on the line, and she had to go through the whole rigmarole again. This time, the name given was a Clifford M. Bennett. She dialed the new number. The phone rang and rang, 10 times at least, before she halted it by hanging up. So she made a tiny question mark beside that name and repeated the process. Next, Dylan D. Bennett. Quickly, she cleared her throat and took a deep breath, trying to look on the bright side of things. Using the phone like this was a very good thing for her to be doing, she thought. Good practice. But she wasn't prepared to have someone answer, not immediately on the first ring.
"The Bennett estate,"
a confident female voice answered. "How may I direct your call?" Suddenly, Katherine felt ill at ease. Her mouth went dry, and she was caught completely off guard, hearing a woman answer the phone this way. She almost wondered if she'd gotten hold of her natural mother by sheer luck.
"Is Laura Mayfield Bennett at home, please?"
she managed.
"I'm sorry, Mrs. Bennett is not available at the moment. May I help you?"
Katherine felt her heart racing and sat down quickly. "Oh, my, now what?" she wondered. This woman talking to her on the other end of the line, this woman holding the telephone receiver up there in New York somewhere, she was saying, in so many words, that Laura Mayfield Bennett, her mother, her real mother, lived there. The Bennett estate. Miss? Is there someone else you wish to speak to? Oh, I'm sorry, Katherine said, rallying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.